morning and welcome to service. Pastor Norgaard, it's such a pleasure to be here and worship with you today. People from near and far, and if it's your first time here, welcome. If it's your 100th time here, welcome. Glad that you're here. And if you're 1,000th time, welcome, welcome here. We begin in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. And then pass the peace with one another. Share the peace with one another. It is lovely to see the activity, the greeting, the sharing of the peace. And now we will start with our worship part.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to worship. Thank you for joining us here to worship the Lord and just lift up His name. Our first song we'll sing today is Mighty to Save. Everyone needs.
And everyone needs compassion, a love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior, the hope of nations.
Savior.
And Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave.
So take me.
So take me as you find me, all my fears and failures. Fill my life again. I give my life to follow everything I believe in. Now I surrender. Yes, I surrender.
Shine your light.
Shine your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Jesus, shine your light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. And Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave.
Savior, one more time.
And Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save.
Just perfect. We said, shine your light, and then the light came on. It's perfect timing. It's wonderful to see as you participate in worship, lift your hands in worship of God, and moving, praying, and closing. It's wonderful to see. Now we'll go and confess our sin to God and receive his absolution. Because if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let us then confess our sins to God our Father. Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us, forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you and for me, and for his sake forgives you all your sins. As a called ordained servant of Christ, it's my pleasure and honor to announce you what he has said, that all your sins are forgiven. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us pray. O God, your divine wisdom sets in order all things in heaven and on earth. Put away from us all things hurtful and give us those things that are beneficial for us. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
The Old Testament reading this morning is from Ecclesiastes, Chapter 5, verses 10 through 20. He who loves money will not be satisfied with money, nor he who loves wealth with his income. This is all vanity. When goods increase, they increase whom eat them, and what advantage has their owner but to see them with his own eyes? Sweet is the sleep of labor, whether he eats little or much, but the full stomach of the rich will not let him sleep. There is grievous evil that I have seen under the sun. Riches were kept by their owners to his hurt, and those riches were lost in a bad venture. And he his as his father of the son, but he has nothing in his hand. As he came from his mother's womb, he shall go again, naked as he came, and shall take nothing for his toil that he may carry away in his hands. This is also a grievous evil. Just as he came, so shall he go, and what gain is there to him who toils for the wind? Moreover, all his days he eats in darkness, in much vexation and sickness and anger. Behold, what I have seen to be good and fitting is to eat and drink and find enjoyment in all toil, within which one toils under the sun the few days of his life that God has given him, for this is his lot. Everyone also to whom God has given wealth and positions and power to enjoy them and to accept his lot and to rejoice in his toil, this is the gift of God. For he will not much remember the days of his life because God keeps him occupied with the joys of his heart. This is the word of the Lord. Our epistle reading this morning is from Hebrews chapter 4, verses 1 through 16. Therefore, while the promise of entering his rest still stands, let us fear, lest any of you should seem to have failed to reach it. For good news came to us just as them, for the message they heard did not benefit them because they were not united by faith with those who listened. For we who have believed entered that rest. And he said, as I swore in my wrath, they shall not enter my rest. Although his works were finished from the foundation of the world, for he has somewhere spoken of the seventh day in this way, as God rested on the seventh day from all his works, again in this passage he said, they shall not enter my rest. Since therefore it remains for some to enter it, and those who formerly receive the good news fail to enter because of disobedience, again he appoints a certain day, today, saying through David so long afterwards, in the words already quoted, today if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts. For if Joshua had given them rest, God would not have spoken of another day later on. So then there remains a Sabbath rest for the people of God. For whoever has entered God's rest has also rested for his work, from his works as God did from his. Let us therefore strive to enter that rest so that no one may fall by the same sort of disobedience. For the word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing to the division of soul and spirit, of joint and of marrow, and discerning the thoughts and intentions of the heart. And no creature is naked, hidden from the sight, but all are exposed to the eyes of him whom we must account. Since then we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus the Son of God. Let us hold fast of confession, for we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who is in every respect has been tempted as we are, yet without sin. Let us then with confidence draw near to the throne of grace that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in the time of need. This is the word of the Lord.
That was just so good news. Did you hear that? We have a high priest who can empathize with us, who has gone through everywhere, gone before us. We'll continue the good news. If you will please stand for the reading of the Holy Gospel according to St. Mark, the 10th chapter. And Jesus looked around and said to his disciples, how difficult it will be for those who have wealth to enter the kingdom of God. And the disciples were amazed at his word. But Jesus said to them again, children, how difficult it is to enter the kingdom of God. It is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich person to enter the kingdom of God. And they were exceedingly astonished and said to him, then who can be saved? Jesus looked at them and said, with man it is impossible, but not with God. For all things are possible with God. Peter began to say to him, see, we have left everything and followed you. Jesus said, truly, I say to you, there is no one who has left house or brothers or sisters or mother or father or children or lands for my sake and for the gospel who will not receive 100-fold now in this time, houses and brothers and sisters and mothers and children and lands with persecutions, and in the age to come, eternal life. But many who are first will be the last, and the last first. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Thank you. All right. All right, who has an animal at home? Wow, almost all of you. What animal? A cat. Cats and dogs. Two cats and a dog. And? Dog? Is that all? And seven chickens. Okay. What's the smallest animal that anyone has? Like, yes. A baby chicken, yes. Your cat is small. Okay. Does anyone have like a mouse? No? In the attic, yeah. That's probably not the best place, but we'll let it count. Anyone has anything smaller than a mouse? Like crickets or worms? Yeah? You have ants. Do you think you can fit an ant through this one here? You think you could? Do you think you can fit a mouse through this one here?
No.
What about a cat?
A baby snake?
A baby, baby, baby. Maybe a worm. Yes, maybe. You don't think you can fit a worm through this one here? You think so? Okay. What's the biggest animal that you have ever seen? Yes. An elephant. You've seen an elephant?
Whale.
A whale. Have you seen a whale? Yeah, like a real one? Not in person, but on pictures, right?
Oh, yeah, I've seen a whale in person.
You have seen it in person? Did you lift it? No, did your dad lift it? Because he's strong, huh? Oh, I thought he would. What's the biggest animal you've seen? You have been like a big animal inside a museum? That is so cool. A big dog. That's big, yes. Yes. Your dog. Yeah, your dog is pretty big. That is right. That's a big dog. But you had seen an elephant.
Yeah, I have.
You know what I have? I have ridden on an elephant one time. That was quite amazing. You know what also I tried sitting on? A camel. A camel. Is also huge. Actually, I think that the head of a camel is higher than the head of an elephant. The back of an elephant is high. And the elephant, I'm telling you, we were on the back of the elephant in the jungle, and the elephant just could just walk across anything. Nothing stopped it. Trees, nothing. Just walk right through it. That was amazing. Snakes, it didn't care about snakes. The elephant wasn't afraid of snakes. It'll just stop. And then no more snake. A mouse. We didn't see any mice that day, but it could be that he was afraid of it. But anyway, an elephant is big. A camel is, yes.
A camel's head isn't as big as a giraffe.
A camel is not as big as a giraffe. It's not as tall as a giraffe. That's true. A giraffe is much, much taller. That's like the longest ever, right? But today we're going to look at a camel. A camel is huge. So I think the hump of a camel is probably up here, and the head is like all the way up there. So how do you get on the back of a camel? Yeah, actually, a camel has weird legs. Its knees goes, what is it? I think goes opposite of ours. So but it can go down on the front knees and back knees, and then you can actually climb up, and then it will rise up with you on top of it. But you got to hold on because it leans forward a lot. So, could you get the camel through this one here?
Yeah.
Okay. What if you shave the camel so there's not all the stickly hair? Can you get it through then?
Yeah.
Okay. What if you shave the camel and put like cream on it, lotion on it, so like olive oil? Could that slip it through?
No.
What if we pushed real, real hard? What? If you shrunk the camel, yeah. If I what?
If
I ate the camel, yeah, but then the camel won't work on the other side anymore. That's true. So today in our story, Jesus says for a rich person to get into heaven, it's like a camel, a huge one, getting through something like this? And is that possible? No, it's not possible. But get in heaven, because that's what we want, right? We want to be with Jesus in heaven. And Jesus says, for ourselves it's not possible, but for God it is. And when he says a rich person is like a camel who has, camel has these humps on the back, has all these things. And when our heart is more focused on the money than it is on God, that's when it's hard for us to get in through. We got to shed all those things, and then God can make it possible. And so it's true. A camel can't get through here, but God, he can get, just like he can get a camel through, he can get us through if our heart is with him. So pray with me. Dear God, thank you for helping us. Help us trust within you and not trust in our money. Help us to love you and not love money. In your name we pray. Amen. All right. Now there's a Sunday kids Sunday school. That's what it was. Blast. That is a strange image that Jesus, he gave today. Let's dive into it. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. That was quite a sound effect. So we're here for two reasons. You are either saved and want to stay saved and enter into the kingdom of heaven, or you're curious about how you can get saved and want to figure out what's all this about Jesus about. Well, I guess there could be a third way. You have been coerced or threatened or somehow manipulated to get here today. If that's the case, I feel sorry for you, and I will try not to drag it out too long. But according to this one here, we are all in trouble. We are all in trouble because we want to get into kingdom, or we're trying to find out. And we, in the text from last week, well, it was before in Mark 10, a rich young man had asked Jesus, so what can I do to earn to get into the kingdom of heaven? And Jesus talked to him and said, you cannot. Actually, you have to do these things. And the guy thought he was smart, like, oh, I've done all that since I was young. And then Jesus could see through everything. He could see his heart. And if you notice one thing, Jesus didn't shame him. Jesus didn't manipulate him. Jesus just addressed him. He does the same with us. Jesus never shames us. That's the accuser who does that. So if there's anything that Jesus addresses with you, know that he does it from love. Because that's what we have. In the last of last week, Jesus loved the young man with love as he walked away. But anyway, before that, Jesus tells him, okay, I want you to sell everything you have and give to the poor. This was not a universal command, but because the young man loved money so much, he knew that was a hindrance for him to enter the kingdom. He wanted to remove that hindrance. But he didn't want to give it up. So for him, it would be equivalent to get a camel through a needle's eye. It is impossible. It's impossible for that man to do that. He'll have to surrender to God, and then he can get in. But wealth can actually be a hindrance for anyone. And you might laugh, well, it's not really me because I'm not really wealthy. Well, what is the definition of wealthy? Wealthy is when, let me make sure I have it from Webster here, having more than enough to gratify normal needs or desires. Having more than enough to gratify normal needs and desires. Well, what is normal needs? Well, I can't drive less than a Lamborghini. I can't wear a bracelet less than a Cartier. My bag has to be a Louis Vuitton. That is normal for me, so of course I have to have a lot of money. So that depends what normal is. Or other people might say, you know what? If I just have clothes to wear, food to eat, and a place to sleep, I'm actually satisfied. And I give God thanks for that. So what is normal? Of course, normal is personal. And so I decided to look at what look at a little bit more people than just us. What does the world look like? Okay, if you make $15,000 a year, you're in the top 10% of the world. That means that for every 10 people, there's you, and then there will be 9 more people that will be making less than $15,000 a year. If you make $50,000 a year, you're in the top 1% in the world. That means there's you, and then there's 99 people that make less than you before the next one making $50,000. If you make $100,000 a year, you're in the top 0.1% in the world. That means there's you, and then there's 999 people. Now we all the way up by In and Out or something like that. 1,000 people before there's another one that makes 100,000 in the world. So you might be saying, I guess I'm rich then. I guess I'm wealthy compared to the rest of the world. Ironically enough, $15,000 is also the poverty level for a single person in Los Angeles. You might be in the top 10% of the world, but it's also the poverty level for one person in Los Angeles. And $15,000 a year, that's like $1,300 a month. Can't get much apartment or food or transportation or entertainment for that. $50,000, that's the top 1% of the world. $50,000 happens to be the poverty level of a family of 4 in Los Angeles. I believe that. Again, depending on what your normal is. But if it's just having place to live, clothes to wear, and food to eat, $50,000 can be spent fairly quickly, even if you're prudent with it. So how do we deal with this and wealth? It's a difficult subject, and it's been treated very differently through times and in different churches. Let's take a stab at it. Jesus is trying to tell a disciple how much of a hindrance that wealth can be to enter the kingdom of heaven. And as hopefully we can see, that it's not wealth itself, but it's how the person treats wealth. So it's not wealth itself that it's condemning, but it's how the person who controls the wealth considers the wealth. So the disciples there are like, what do you mean it's difficult? Because in the Hebrew culture, in the Israeli culture back in time, if someone were wealthy, they were blessed. Look at Abraham. He was God's friend. He was the father of Israelites. He was the one who showed the way in trusting in God and being saved by his trust in him, in his faith. And he was blessed immensely, thousands of animals and riches. He was blessed. King Solomon was blessed. Absolutely. But it is how the wealthy person considers the wealth that is the issue. So Jesus is trying to show that to the disciples. So as Jesus is saying that, they are amazed. They cannot understand because it challenged their understanding. That's what Jesus does. He challenged our understanding of many things in our lives. And as they're challenged, Jesus is realizing I need to make it really clear for them. And he gives them another image. And it's interesting to see the word that's used here when Jesus looks at them. He doesn't just look and observe them, oh, there's a person sitting there. And it's like, no, he sees them. He surveys them. He understands where they're at. So he gives them another image. It's like getting a camel through a needle. And there's many ways to interpret that, but no matter how you interpret it, it just means it's really difficult. And from their reaction, the disciples' reaction, it could look like Jesus is actually trying to say to them, like a needle that you take a camel through. And that's the kids say, you can't do that. Like, no, that's right. You can't do it. For humans, in the human way, you cannot do it. But God can do it. God can do it. And Jesus showed. remember one thing, is that Jesus is saying this here a week or two before his crucifixion. Just think of that for a second. It is not some far out thing that's going to happen way down the line. This is 2 weeks out. 2 weeks out, and he knows that he'll be on the cross, paving the way, making it possible for us to come to God. If we trust in him, if we believe in him, if we trust in our wealth, we're going to end same place as the rich young ruler. But how do we solve the thing about money and wealth and Jesus as Lord? Because we do need money right now to live. We do. We do need money. We do need means to live right now. At the same time, we do also not want the money to hinder our way to eternal life. How can we do both? It is impossible for us, but not for God. Because if we trust God to make money and we trust God to spend our money, if we trust in God to make our money and we trust in God to spend our money, then we are ruled not by money, but we are ruled by God. And if we are able to say, God, it is all yours, everything I have, own, earn, receive, is all yours. You give it to me. You give it to me to steward. But it's all yours. It doesn't mean that. So when we say it's all yours, doesn't mean like, oh, then I should feel bad if I say that. No. Just like you like to give gifts to your kids. You love to see, give your kid something and their face light up. They play with the toy all day long or whatever it is. It's a joy to you to give them something. Or you love to cook them their favorite meal because you just see the smile on their face. You just see how they light up, like, I get to have that? Yes. That's how God is. God doesn't have a problem in blessing us. God wants to give us things that we can enjoy and live as long as we give him thanks for it, as long as we say it's yours, God. He doesn't have a problem with it. He doesn't have a problem with it. It is when we begin to take one of those two, God, you gave everything, you helped me get everything, you told me to steward it, or God, you are showing me how I can spend this for the kingdom. The moment that we take one of those two out and we begin to control, I want to control that, I'm in charge of making my money, I'm in charge of spending my money, that's when trouble begins. I have seen poor people be greedier than wealthy people. And I've seen wealthy people be greedier than poor people. You can have $10 in your pocket, and you can be like, this is the last money I have, this is the only I have, I cannot afford, I really got to hold on to this because who knows what I will get. Be so greedy that you cannot depart with it. You can have $1,000 in your pocket and say, God, he gave everything. He gave all this to me. He could quickly give me another 1,000. Sure. You need to? Okay, here, you go. If you give it because you give it because of the kingdom, and you give God thanks, it was God who gave it to me, God is leading me to give again, I have no problem giving, that person is more generous than the one with the $10 holding on to it. That person is more greedy. These $10 are mine. I worked hard for it. I did this. These are the last I have. I cannot afford to give them away. And you can reverse it. You can have someone with $10 saying, I might be homeless. I have only $10. Oh, you need $10? Oh, here you go. I'll make another $10. That person is not greedy. You can have a person with $1,000 be like, oh, no, I worked really hard for these $1,000. You have no idea how hard I worked, how long I worked. And these $1,000, I need them because I need it. I cannot possibly give anything away from it. Now, this person is more greedy than the other one. It is the way you think about how you earn it and the way you think about how you depart with it, that's where your heart is. That's what Jesus is talking about. Again, it's not the love, it's not money itself, it's the love of money that is the root of all evil. Because we often hear, oh, money is the root of all evil. No, that is not biblical. It is the love of money that is the root of all evil. It's the love of money. Because money is just a tool. Money is just like a knife. You can use it to cut and prepare the most delicious food, or you can use it to harm people. Money is the same. You can use money to do all kind of wonderful things for the kingdom of God. Or you can hoard it, and as we heard in the text from Ecclesiastic today, you can hoard it, and then it's going to be wasted, and then you're going to die, and somebody else is going to spend it. So it's how you look at money. And the question is, what is your identity with money? Are they yours, or are they God? And do we really believe that He is our Lord? And what does it mean that someone is the Lord of us? That someone is Lord, that means that they call all shots. So if someone is Lord, they make all decisions, or they have all authority, the final authority. They can delegate decision, like I want you to be generous to the poor. I want you to consider others, not be whatever. He can give a certain task, but He's the Lord of everything. He's the one I think of as I owe everything. Not that I can be sad or grumpy or afraid, but that I can enjoy and serve and live. And Jesus wants to be Lord of us in all situations of life, also in our money. And sometimes we have to deal with money as in like a practical matter. And for example, I don't know how many of you have lived in a dorm in your younger years, but let me take you back to some dorm years. Sitting in the dorm around the kitchen table, there's you and three other guys or gals maybe. And you're like, okay, well, let's have a meeting. We need to pay the rent. It's $800 and we only have $350. We've got to figure something out, right? So you have a kitchen. You sit at the kitchen table figuring things out. That's being responsible with money as well. And the same for us here. I'm going to talk just for a quick moment about budget and finances for our church. This is our meeting around the kitchen table. The dining room table is up there, okay? That's when we sit and dine with Jesus. Right now we're having kitchen table discussion. And if you are a guest here today, this talk about money is for the family, for those that call this church a home. If you're a guest, can excuse you for a few moments, or actually you might want to listen in and hear how kingdom stuff is handled. Because if you're considering becoming a Christian, the kingdom stuff will apply to you one day as well. Because the last thing that gets converted in a person is their wallet. Martin Luther has been quoted to say that the last thing that gets converted is a person's wallet. And that's exactly what Jesus was talking about today. Just earlier this week, we had a church council meeting, and they're like church council meetings are often. It's a matter of getting things done, taking care of some business. And that meeting was the same. Not a lot of giggle and fun. But we had a talk about budget the other evening, and it was actually a good talk. And one thing that was brought up is that we actually need to paint the roof of some of the buildings here. They need to paint it white to reduce the heat and to keep them tight for the rainy season that are coming in. And we need to do it now. But we don't have it in the budget. And some of the really bright people on the council was like, okay, we have this area that need to be covered. We need about 40 buckets of paint, and they cost $100 each. That means we need $4,000 to cover it before Thanksgiving. And it's one of those things where you have the kitchen table of figuring things out. Just like if you're sitting at the kitchen table, say, we want to go to Disneyland, but our car needs repair. Do we spend $500 on Disneyland, or do we fix our car? Because if we don't fix our car, it will break down and it will cost us $5,000. So it's better to spend 500 on the car and not go to Disneyland. That's the reasonable things to do. And right now, it is better that we spend $4,000 on paint on the roof than spending $40,000 on a leaked roof that will damage a room. That's where we're at. So one bright person said, oh, what if we say buy a bucket? We just need to buy 40 buckets. Do you think that there could be 40 people in the church that would buy a bucket for $100 of that special paint? I think so. And then there were a couple people like, I'll buy a bucket. I'm like, I'll buy a bucket. And that's great. So we have a handful of bucket always paid. So I think maybe next Sunday there'll be a bucket where you can put in and we can actually get those bucket paid. Because our budget is right now is not the best. So yeah, you can pray about that. And I'm not coercing anyone, but pray about it. What does the body of God need? Then, going back to our text, Jesus is talking about money, talking about our hearts. And then Peter, I love that guy because he says what some of us might be thinking. Okay, Jesus, but what about us? We have done so much for the kingdom already. So, brownie points for me? And Jesus is answering him, but not really answering him exactly like he wanted to. He's not saying, oh, yeah, Peter, you're off the hook. You don't have to worry about a thing. No, he's saying, if anyone has given anything up for the kingdom of God, you will receive it hundredfold again. If you're giving up family, siblings, parents, homes, fields, if you're giving it up, you will receive hundredfold again, both in this time and the time to come. This time will be with persecution. Don't think it's just if you give to the kingdom of God now, you will receive hundredfold again and it'll just be smooth sailing. You won't hear anything else. No, it will be persecution. Jesus warns us. His way to the cross was not without persecution. But there's also going to be reward in the time to come. And think about that. Hundredfold, that's a lot. And I would say in my personal life, I have experienced that the times when I gave up something, had to give up something, I have been blessed many times again. The not being around my family, and yet I have a family here. People that are closer to than some of my own family. That's the kingdom of God where I receive manifold again. And at times when God has called me to give something, and sometimes I'm like, okay, here we go. And then I give it. And then God has shown, don't worry, I got you. And he did. One time, forgive me if you heard it before, but one time I was working as a part-time assistant pastor, not making a whole lot, because part-time assistant pastors, they don't make a whole lot. And so I worked on the side. And then God said, I want you to stop that work. And I was like, but God, 2 and 2 doesn't make 7. I got to do something to make it just to meet ends. And God just said, no, I want you to not. But that's scary. He just trust me. I did. And it was scary. But for the next 14 months, not just one time, but for the next 14 months, all our needs were covered. We had 7. Let's just use that as a number. We had 7 at the end of every month, even though that we only had less than that. Somehow, out of the blue, people came, oh, one time the radiator in our car bust open. That was a $200 repair. We didn't have $200. A check was dropped in our mailbox for $200. Exactly what we needed. God sees it, but God, he wants to know our hearts. And if there's anything that I can share with the text for today, is that God wants to know your heart. God does not have a problem with you making money. God does not have a problem with you making $500,000 a year or $1 million a year. But if that million is going to take your heart away from him, he would rather you make 50 and then make it home to him. But if he can trust you with 50 and you're saying, oh, I got those 50 from God, I'm going to spend, you know, I'm going to, of course, live reasonable and responsibly, but I want to do kingdom work. I want to do kingdom stuff. God's like, ah, she can handle it. Okay, let her have 100. And like, oh, God, he gave me 100. Now I can do even more for the kingdom. But if the person say, oh, now I have 100. Well, I should stash the 50 away and hoard them for myself and make sure that nobody else gets them. Then God will be like, wait a second, where's the sweet little girl that I had that wanted the kingdom work? Now she's like all caught up in money. I don't want her to be that. That's the heart we see of Jesus with the young man. He's excited about the young man. He loves the young man. But he's sad to see him walk away because he's hoarding the money. He wanted the young man to get rid of the burden of being under the money. So sell everything you have and give it to the poor and come and follow me. If he had done that, look at what happened to the disciples that left everything and followed him. The two brothers, John and James, their father, Zebedee, had a thriving fishing business in the Sea of Galilee. They were to take that over. They left that to follow Jesus. And they were blessed. Look at the legacy. Look at the things that they have, the imprint they have made on the whole world. John, he wrote one of the Gospels. Just imagine that. Talk about 100-fold again, 1,000,000-fold again. He followed Jesus. But that young man, if he had followed Jesus, that doesn't mean that he will have no money or be poor all his life. The essence is that Jesus be the Lord of how you make your money. Let Jesus be the Lord of how you spend the money. That's what it's about, because then we can get through and be with him in eternity. Amen. Jesus, we thank you for all the things that you have blessed us with, that you have trusted us with. Lord, forgive us those times when we become greedy and selfish, where we suddenly listen to the lies and we become fearful that maybe you won't provide next month, so I have to take care of things myself. No, Lord, help us to trust you. Help us to be generous when you call us to. And help us to be prudent. Help us to put aside. Help us to store up for when that is needed. Lord, you call us to be responsible in all matters. Help us to be that. But most of all, help us to trust you, that you are the Lord of our hearts, both now and in the time to come. In Jesus' name, amen. And if you'll stand with me and say the Nicene Creed.
I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for all salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried. On the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures and ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Heavenly Father, we now come before you. You have said that we can lift up things that are heavy upon our hearts, things that we are thankful for, thankful that we are worried for, things that we are uncertain about. So we come to you now. We pray that you will help us and lead us and guide us. We pray that you will help us to increase our budget, that you increase what we need, that you provide what is needed here. Lord, that you give us trust and joy in seeing the budget being met. We pray for those who are in need. We pray for those who have lost their homes, who have lost their livelihoods, even those who have lost their lives in the hurricanes, Helena and Ellen. We pray that you will come and see to them. Lord, you bring hope and help in time of need. We also pray for this country during this time of season of election. Lord, we pray for truth, pray for your will, we pray for righteousness, we pray for justice. We pray that each of the candidates will listen to your word and bow down to your word only, be guided by your word. We pray for our current president, pray for the governor of this state and the mayor of this city. May they bow to your word and follow your guidance and your leading. We pray for the peace of Jerusalem, the nation of Israel. Lord, have mercy. Bring the weapons to silence and bring your peace. We pray for our brothers and sisters throughout the world, those who confess your name. Help them to be strong. Help them to be clear, even to the end of life. We pray for Christ Lutheran. Lord, we give thanks for our next pastor, Jonathan Brandenburg. We pray that you will bless him and his family, go before them in this time of transition. Lord, we also pray for the people in our midst. We pray for Pastor Enoch's family in Haiti. Pray for Sue Berg, John Bogle, Aaron Abey, Sonia Garcia, Auntie Mava, Belen Perez, Jasmine Perez, Nadine Sayer. Lord, we pray that you will see to them, that you will meet them. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Amen. You may be seated as we take up the offering. Lord, we lift up these gifts. Give thanks that you have entrusted them to us. We ask that you will take these and multiply them to your glory and the blessing of your church. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let's give thanks and praise unto the Lord our God. Yes, it is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God, through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who on this day overcame death, the grave, and by his glorious resurrection, opened to us the way of everlasting life. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and singing. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. It was the night that our Lord Jesus was betrayed. He took bread. After giving thanks, he broke it and he gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Same way, after supper, he took the cup and after giving thanks, gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and drink. This cup is a new covenant in my blood, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you. And in a moment, we will invite everybody to come up here. We teach and believe that this is the body and the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. And if you believe that and are baptized, you're welcome to come and receive as well. If you're not sure what this means, you are welcome to come forward, fold your hand, and we will give you a blessing. And you can receive that way. And then we will sing Agnus.
Jealous for me, love's like a hurricane. I am a tree bending beneath the weight of his wind and mercy. When all of a sudden I am unaware of these afflictions eclipse my glory, and I realize just how beautiful you are and how great your affections are for me. And oh, how he loves us so. And oh, how he loves us. How he loves us. He loves us. dawn to redemption by the grace in his eyes. If grace is an ocean, we're all sinking. And heaven meets earth like an unforeseen kiss. And my heart turns violently inside of my chest. I don't have time to maintain these regrets when I think about the way that he loves us. Oh, how he loves us. Oh, how he loves us. Oh, how he loves. Yeah, he loves us. Oh, how he loves us. Oh, how he loves us. Oh, how he loves. The world that he gave us, his one and only Son to save us. Whoever believes in him will live forever.
Come on.
Come all you weary, come all you thirsty, come to the well that never runs dry. Drink of his water, come and thirst no more. Come all you sinners, come find his mercy. Come to the table, he will satisfy. Taste of his goodness, find what you're looking for. For God so loved the world that he gave us, his one and only Son to save us. Whoever believes in him will live forever.
The power of hell.
The power of hell, forever defeated. Now it is well, I'm walking in freedom. For God so loved, God so loved the world. And praise God, praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, praise him, for the wonders of his love.
Praise God.
Praise God, praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, praise him, for the wonders of his love. For God so loved the world that he gave us, his one and only Son to save us. Whoever believes in him will live forever.
Let us pray. Almighty God, in this feast you give us a foretaste of what is to come when your kingdom comes in full. Forgiveness of our sins, life and salvation. We ask that as you gave Israel rest from their enemies, when they obeyed you, that you would give us respite from our enemies here, devil, the world, and our sinful flesh, that we may serve you in peace and quietness here and have a foretaste of the rest you promise. We ask this, Father, in the name of Jesus, who with you and the Holy Spirit is one God, now and forever. Amen. Please rise and receive the benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord let his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen.
We sing our closing song.
Go in peace and serve the Lord. Serve the Lord.